Sponsored by the Big 98, Nashville's number one for new country and the home of the Bobby Bones Show.
We're so thrilled to have on award-winning songwriter, singer, entertainer. He's really hitting the charts and making a big splash right now. Drew Ryder-Smith. Drew, thanks for coming on the show.
Yeah, man, thank you for having me.
You know, I got to tell this story now. After we met out at Leaper's Fork, and you were playing part of this songwriter round, and I'm reading, I'm introducing, I'm listening to you, and then I told your PR people, I have to have Drew on the show.
I told them the same thing. I said, I got to be on Eric's show.
Well, you know what? We do have the same fans.
We do.
Because I went up to meet a couple of your fans, and they had the VIP lanyards, Drew Ryder-Smith right there. And I'm like going, hey, nice to meet you. And they're like, oh, yeah, we watch your show. I'm like going, these are our people.
That's right. That's right. We should just go on the road together.
We should. I'll just introduce you.
That'd be great, man.
Just like now.
Come
like
out, play
opener.
Some guitar.
Well, we got to talk about this new EP. You know, and I got to hear you play some of the songs out there, but wow.
Thank you,
man. I mean, this is a powerful, you know, self-titled EP. And I think one of my favorite songs on here, and I know it's doing well for you on playlists and everything, is X's.
Yeah, yeah, really love that song, man. I wrote that. It started as a joke, and then I took off with it. And I started it, finished it with my buddy Rob Snyder, who I've been friends with for years. He's a great songwriter.
Yeah.
And I sent it to him, and I said, man, you want to write this with me? He said, absolutely. So we hooked up, we finished it together. He sang background vocals on it. And,
you know, I was joking before we came in studio, and you and I both have a guitar addiction anyway, so
we
stay in touch on that. But I feel like this EP is like your Taylor Swift EP, but from the man's perspective.
It is, yeah. Yeah. Well, you remember, you know, her first single, that Drew Looks At Me. That was, I'm the guy.
That was about you.
That was, yeah.
See, then the correlation makes sense.
Right, and now this EP is all about her. I gave her like 15 years
right.
to do her thing.
I think that was kind of you.
Well, it was the thing to do.
Well, especially, you know, you let her career get going, and now you're an instant success.
Absolutely.
After being here in Tennessee. And once again, I got to brag on you. I mean, you've had songs with Merle Haggard, John Schneider. The list goes on and on.
Yeah, yeah. It's been great, man. I've been real blessed.
Very blessed. And also to be able to be on stage, you got to tell the Merle story. At the Ryman.
Oh, yeah.
You know, to where it's like, you know, you're backstage and like he gave you, like made sure you were set up in the better room.
He did, yeah, yeah.
It was the wild. Merle Haggard.
The Merle Haggard. Yeah, the one and only Merle Haggard. He gave me the big artist green room. And he said, no, you could have it. And I thought that was awfully sweet of him. I mean, he's Merle Haggard. He could have all the green rooms if he wanted.
Yeah.
He deserves them. He's earned them, that's for sure. And but he was, yeah, he was super kind to me, yeah.
Well, and you've opened up for other major artists too, like Big and Rich, Lady A. I mean, it's so interesting to me, and particularly with this EP that I think is so powerful. There's so many great songs on here. You know, it would be hard for me to pick out which one's the best single. I think X's stands out.
Thanks, man.
But you know, there's no bad songs in here.
Thank you. Thank you. We're planning on putting all the bad ones on the next EP. So.
Or giving those to other people to
give them to somebody else, yeah.
You save the cream.
Yeah, that's
for
right.
You.
That's right. That's what I'm doing. I'm being selfish.
But, you know, you're so well known as a songwriter here in Nashville and a go-to. And once again, I got to throw out a major name in the songwriter community, Don Schlitz.
Yeah, yeah. I love Don, man. He was one of my songwriting heroes growing up.
Gambler.
The gambler.
I mean, how many Kenny Rogers hits?
Yeah. When You Say Nothing At All, yeah.
Come on.
On the other hand.
And you're working, you're writing with these people.
Yeah, yeah, that's been great, man. Don was one that, when I got shortly after I got my first publishing deal, I met Don in a Starbucks. And I used to go to, you remember when he did Don for a Dollar at Bluebird?
Right.
And he would do that like once a month or something. I would go to his shows, and I met him at the Bucks one day. And introduced myself, and he asked me to send him a few things, and so I sent him some songs, and he emailed me, so we got a ride. And I thought, oh no. Oh no, what have I done?
There.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And but he, yeah, super sweet to me, very kind. So.
Wow.
Yeah.
How incredible. And you know, once again, you know, being in the songwriting community, you and I were talking before we came in studio, and certainly with the new EP out that's doing so well, and with so many hit singles on it, you're gonna have videos and everything else rolling out. How do you decide what songs you allow other artists to record or that you keep for Drew?
Man, there, you know, when we were talking off camera, I said that, you know, X's was one that I wanted to save because I really, really loved it. I think most of the new material that I'm writing, as a writer, you know how it is, man. Like, it's always your new favorite.
Totally.
You know, and tomorrow will be your new favorite.
Right.
And Wednesday's new song will be your new favorite. But for me, man, I love getting cuts, and that's what I've done for so long, and that's what's made my living. And so if somebody wants to cut it, then that's great. It would take something deeply personal. There's a couple on that EP that I would want to keep just solely for myself, the truth being one of them.
I was just going to bring that up, because what grabbed me about the truth, once again, were the heartfelt lyrics, but also the piano. And I think, like you and I were discussing too, what I admired about this EP, Drew, and it shows when you play a songwriter around also, is that the songs can stand alone. You know, the sparseness of instrumentation, and certainly the warmer sound that you achieved, you know, with all of these songs.
Sure. Yeah, man, it's, I think now with everything that's going on in our digital age of recording, it's real easy to make everything really slick and really shining and super perfect. And we just didn't want to do that. So there's a lot of fun little imperfections throughout the EP, and
you
hear fret squeaks and things like that.
I like that. To me, it sounds real. I mean, it's kind of different than what Taylor Swift did with your songs, you know, when she was writing about Drew.
Exactly.
You know, she was going all digital, all the way.
Super slick.
You were like the antithesis of that.
That's right. Right. Well, again, I wanted to take what she was doing and do the opposite, so I didn't step on her toes.
Very kind of you. Once again, I got to bring this up too.
I'm a great ex-boyfriend.
Just like we were talking on clothing too, right?
That's right.
It's amazing. But we got to talk about this, to where you started playing guitar at 10 years old.
I did.
And your mom's side of the family is very musical. And so you got it naturally.
I got that part of it naturally. I got the playing part naturally, not so much the singing. Yeah.
Then why do your vocals keep sounding better? Because I've heard your past stuff.
Auto-tune.
No, not buying it. But it's like your vocals, you know, even seeing you live, obviously, you know, it seems like you're really going deep. And is that because of the lyrics or the songs or what? Because it sounds to me so much different than stuff you've done in the past.
Man, I feel like it sounds crazy to say, but I feel like I've been singing from a different place for the last couple of years.
Okay.
And it's wild to me. I've been an artist for so many years, and I feel like I'm just now finding my voice.
Mm-hmm.
I think so many artists are like that, and we're all afraid to talk about it because we're insecure.
And I think some of them never find their voice. I think, like you and I were talking about it too, Drew, to where with labels and everything else, you know, sometimes they get pushed in different directions and all that. But, you know, being independent like you are right now, even though you've had labels come to you and want you, you're able to do it your way.
Sure.
And you're able to take the time to find your voice like you have with this.
Yeah. There's a ton of freedom in that, man. It's a really, really wonderful thing. It'll get you in trouble sometimes too. if I'm left to my own devices, but I work with a great guy, Russell Jackson. He and I have been co-producing all this stuff together, and I've been producing stuff on other artists for years.
Right.
And I hooked up with Russell last year, and man, we've just been so happy with what we're doing. But I feel like Russell and we work in a way that we kind of keep each other out of trouble.
Mm-hmm.
And so when one of us wants to get a little too weird, the other one says, I don't know, man, maybe pull it back a little. And I really think that's been our saving grace.
Well, and speaking of saving grace, you know, once again, to touch on when you, you know, were touring playing with Merle Haggard, what was it like playing at the Ryman and playing in front of all of these huge executives, all of these huge music people, and there you are at the Mother Church playing on the stage?
It was wild, man. I mean, just to be there was it was a very deer in headlights feeling.
Right.
I was really fortunate, Eric. Some years prior to that, I talked to it was a friend of mine. He was playing bass for me at the time, and he was we were playing a gig here in town, and he said, "Listen, I might be there just a couple of minutes late. I'm playing the Opry right before our gig, but I'll be there, I promise."
Right.
And I said, okay. And so that night, and I was new to town, and I was just blown away by the idea that this guy was playing the Opry and then he was going to come play with me. And I thought, well, he should just go home after the Opry. You
know? Right. But still.
But so I talked to him after the gig, and I said, and again, I'm new to town. I was like, man, what's it like playing at the Ryman, you know, at the Opry? That's incredible, right? Mm-hmm. And he said, you know what, honestly, he said, I didn't even, the first few times, I don't even remember it. I didn't even enjoy it. He said, I was just so shocked by the feeling as soon as I walked out on that stage. he said, it'll really overtake you if you're not careful. And he said, so it wasn't until like the third, fourth, or fifth time that I played that I was able to actually enjoy it. Mm. And that, for whatever reason, that short conversation always stuck with me.
Right.
And so, so when I played, I kind of had that in the back of my head, and I thought, all right, man, you've got to try not to be too overcome with emotion right now and enjoy it, because I knew that I would really get ahead of myself. Mm-hmm. You know, if I walked out on the stage and the lights came up, I knew it would be over. And so,
well, especially being at the Ryman and, you know, thinking to myself, and certainly, you know, you've played the Bluebird, you've played so many major venues over the years now, but when you look out into the crowd and you're seeing all of these major people that, you know, I mean, you know, it's like that, you know, you see the Tim McGraws, you see the people that you've shared the stage with, and they're looking back at you on stage performing.
Yeah. Yeah. That was a crazy feeling. I got really lucky. John Prine is another one of my heroes. And I didn't notice Prine until my very last song, and the lights in the crowd came up, and I looked up and John Prine was standing there and he applauding. And I went, man, thank God I didn't see him until the end, because that would have been the moment that I'd have lost it.
Yeah, so, that's what it's like going, I wonder what the lyrics are to this song. Oh, wait, I wrote it.
Right.
That's amazing. I mean, what a great way to come forward with this, with your songwriting. I mean, obviously, you've won gold awards, you know, with your songs already. And now to be able to put that focus on yourself as a solo artist, and you've got your own studio, you know, and so, you know, it's got to be a great time for you right now.
It is, man. It's, you know, at first it was a little shaky because I have done, you know, reasonably well as a songwriter.
More than reasonably well.
And so you think, well, okay, everyone knows me, you know, for this. Mm-hmm. And if I do the artist thing and fall on my face, you know, what's that going to look like? And so it's really easy to stand on the solid ground that you've been on for years. Mm-hmm. But man, after I got past a couple of releases, I thought, you know what, it doesn't matter.
No.
And so I'm having a great time, man. It's really, really awesome. Got a great team.
Right.
And so really blessed.
Well, and I mean, the EP just came out this year. Of course, the question I have to ask you that viewers are going to want to know, are you already working on songs for the next release?
Oh man, we've got tons. Yeah. Yeah, we've got tons.
Because, you know, that's always the question. It's like,
always.
Wow, this is great. What's coming out
What's
next?
What's next? Yeah. And when? Yeah.
Yeah. So no pressure there.
No pressure there, man. We, you know, Russell and I, I never walked in and said, hey, man, here's the list of songs for the EP, and this is what we're going to do. It's not our process at all. We record what we're excited about at the time. And if we're not excited about it, then we record something else and then come back to it later. But as a result of that, you know, we're not doing anything, like we're not trying to be cohesive. Mm-hmm. And so we're just recording and we're excited and we're feeling good about it. And then the things that just seem to that naturally are cohesive together, that's kind of what we're putting together. So we've got stuff on the shelf that's ready to go. So we're not behind.
Right.
I'll say that. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, especially with Gray Studio and everything, it's like, you know, the warm sound you're getting with the tape. And these songs also, I mean, as I mentioned, especially with X's and The Truth, you know, and Damn Babe, it's like, you know, I could see these being a part in film and in TV, used in so many other ways, you know, besides you performing them live, obviously.
Well, we're lobbying for any of those songs to be your new opening song.
I think we can make that happen.
Yeah.
Yeah, any of those. In fact, any track on this EP.
Yeah.
And we were talking too, you're going to have more singles dropping, more music videos.
Yeah, I think we're going to get into some of the actual, you know, video stuff.
New realm for you.
It is. Yeah, it's terrifying. So
that's why you got to do it.
Well, either that or that's why I've got to hire a lookalike.
Stunt double. Yeah.
Yeah, there's got to be one out there.
I think you can make this work, Joe.
I hope so, man. We're going to try it.
I got faith.
Thanks, man.
Well, I want to make sure for our viewers, for your shows, for the music, for everything that you got going on, also the cool merch, you know, for the website, social media, where do viewers need to go?
Man, everybody needs to go to drewrydersmith.com. That's R-Y-D-E-R. All the socials are at Drew Ryder Smith. So everything you need to know is all there, man.
Well, and I also like it with Drew Ryder Smith, because also then promoters and everything will know when you go and play these major venues that there's going to be a unique rider
That's right.
Required.
That is right.
Just to get the show and the band there, right?
That's exactly right.
Maybe some unique things asked for.
Absolutely. Balloon animals.
Anything could happen.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what, congratulations on a great EP. Amazing songs. You know, however you're consuming music right now, and once again, this is one of those, you've heard me say this before, I wish this would go to vinyl because it's so good. It's so warm. But however you consume music, whether it's by, you know, Spotify, playlist, whatever you listen on, find Drew Ryder-Smith. You're going to thank me. I've been turning a lot of friends onto his music. Go see him live, though. It's even better. You can see if, you know, if Merle Haggard liked Drew, it has to be right. And if you got John Prine applauding for you at the Ryman, I think those guys probably know more than I do about music. Just saying it for the record.
Thank you, man.
But anyway, be sure and check him out. Drew Ryder-Smith, you're going to love all the music. More new music coming out all the time. Videos, no stunt double, and cool merch. You heard it here first. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate you, man.
Sponsored by the Big 98, Nashville's number one for new country and the home of the Bobby Bones Show.